One, two, get down.
Yes, legends, we're back for another episode. This is 26 Podcast. I'm your host, Rogan
Paid
McJoy.
The cost to be the boss. Paid the cost to be the boss. I paid the cost.
Welcome to 26 Podcast. I've spent a little bit of time not doing these episodes, and I can't believe that I'm actually saying this, but I am here with good friend John Baird. Birdie, how are you, mate?
Delighted to see you, mate. Absolutely delighted.
It's one of those where, honestly, a couple of years ago when all of this was a conversation, none of this stuff was purchased, I used to talk to Jay about getting you on this channel. So even coming here last night, seeing you, it's just surreal. But it's an amazing feeling, I've got to admit.
The fact that you have actually made the effort to come to Melbourne to come here, mate, is an absolute privilege, honestly. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, no, it's going to be good. Just to give the viewers a little bit of an insight, I live in Melbourne. Myself and Brad flew from Melbourne to Perth to get this episode underway. And what a night last night, mate. I woke up a bit, what is it, dusty?
Well, that's an Australian thing, do you know what I mean? That's what they say here, dusty, but I would say hangover.
Hungover
in Scotland.
That vodka celli, I think that's what done me.
It was good. That was a good night, but
that was quality. Aye. That was really, really good.
Good bunch of people, eh?
Yeah.
Very, very good people, man.
We were watching your goals again on YouTube this morning, and I'm not having that you're right-footed, mate. I'm not having it. I think you're lefty.
Well, you mentioned this last night. I've done it to my grandad, because every time I used to go down the left-hand side to have a goal, I mean, I remember it for like 7-year-old, and I would kick it with my right. My granddad, just very basic, we go, look at the size of the goal you're hitting it. If you go with your left, it's that size. So then I would consistently, nobody took me out to practice. I went and done it myself, but he just gave me a bit of information, and I took it on, and that was it. And I'm probably more comfortable finishing with my left hip when the ball's rolling, but if it was a set piece, I would be better with my right. But penalty kicks and corners and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But no, I know what you're saying. But that was for my granda.
Yeah, quality. Some worldy goals. We're going to hit the rewind button, Birdie, and go back to where you were born and bred.
A place called Sandy Hills, which is in Glasgow, a Toll Cross area. When I think about that place, it makes me smile. It was everything to me. I stayed there all my life. I moved a couple of times, obviously, because football and all that, but we always had a house back home when I was in a situation that we could go away and come back. That's the happiest, a very, very happy bit of my life. I met my wife there. She stayed, I'm trying to think, man, about 400 yards or something away. But metres in Australia, they don't use yards, use metres.
Yeah.
When I actually realised that when I was telling a kid to move 5 yards in coaching, but so I owe that place. My dad's family are for Toll Cross, my mum's family are for Toll Cross, so we're Toll Cross people.
Were you always kicking the ball about?
Yeah, constantly. I loved competing, everything about competing and stuff like that, and I liked arranging games, like street games with street teams, and we stayed in a cul-de-sac in Sandy Hills. It was Toll Cross, and we had a street team. Like, we were good, man. One of the boys actually played with Hibs as well on the team. He was supposed to go to Fulham, but then fell out the game, but he was a good player, boy John Kane. And that cul-de-sac was heaven. You know what it's like, Wimbledon was on, you're playing tennis, and that was it. It was your wee island. It was brilliant.
It's quality, innit? When you grow up, I was very much
same. I've never thought about that for a long, long time.
Really?
That's nice, man.
When you grow up and you just got everyone playing, no care in the world. No. I often say, you know when we turn up to pitches now, we start turning our nose up and going, oh, it's bobbly, it's this. When you're a kid, you just play on anything, eh?
Well, that's the thing, right? Because you know what it's like, obviously, playing in the game, Melbourne, people are playing on the pitch before you, and it's something that's really annoyed me here because of the level I've been at. But see, even like training, just take the bubbles out it, man, bang it through. That's what you've done when you're younger. You just banged it through and you played. See, when you got a bit of grass, you were like, wow, this is amazing.
Yeah.
That was what it was all about. But it is, it's there was no excuses when you're younger. There's plenty now, man.
All the time. We hear enough, don't we? We spoke about that last night as well.
Too many.
Who was your first football team and how old were you?
A team called Wolves Boys Club, which was in Carmyle. I was 7 years old. My first experience was, that I can remember, by all accounts, I was told that was no bad. I was all right. My first experience was missing a penalty in a cup final. Nothing else before that I can remember, but I remember missing a penalty. And the other ones was winning Player of the Year awards. I was obsessed about winning Player of the Year awards. And I remember one year I never got it, right? I got Players Player, but I never got Player of the Year. And the coach, and we'll get into this, my old man wouldn't say much, right? And I remember my dad's, because I was upset about it. I'm still getting annoyed to me to this day. It's fucking 9 years. But I was 9 years old, right? 9 years old. And I got Players Player for I was seven right up. And I was obsessed about winning that. Just, I don't know. Maybe a selfish. It's no selfish club that. No, I want to be the fucking best. You got to swear on this?
Yeah, do whatever you want, mate.
I want to be the best in it. And I remember, and they said, no disrespect to the guy that won it, but they went, look, we couldn't give you another year, but we stopped, you won Player of the Year. And I was like, I remember thinking, that's not good enough. I left the next year. I went to another boys club. I went to end up going to Rangers, which I was a Celtic fan. A Celtic family, because my mum and dad aren't really into football and that, but we are Celtic minded if you want to get into that side of things. So it was that it's weird that hurt me, and it still hurts me. That was my trophy.
I think, going back to last night, talking to some of your players, because you're obviously coach here at Mandarin City, we'll get on to that a little bit later on, but I do want to just touch on, I spoke to a couple of your players last night and your assistant coaches, and one thing that everyone says about you is that you are 100% guy. So when it comes to playing, you play 100%. The things that you're doing off the park, 100%. Do you think that, yeah, you look at that now and you go, oh, maybe it's a little bit too much, I was upset about that. But do you look at it and go, well, all the things that you did achieve in your career, you had to have that little bit, or you have to have that in your mind, didn't you?
I think that was a good thing. Looking back, it annoyed me. But it wasn't adversity, but it was a kick in the balls, because I was like, no, I deserved that. So I felt, no, I'll get it somewhere else. And later on in the conversation, I'll tell you a story about another thing that I felt that I should have got a trophy that I never got. And that, it pissed me off, but it was a good thing. And when I'm looking back, you actually asked me the questions, nobody's ever asked me that. It's like, what? I didn't even realise that annoyed me as much. But I get what you're coming for. Definitely, that's probably made me. I like proving people wrong. I can't hide that.
It takes a lot being a professional footballer. We've all had players that have had ability. Myself had ability. There's hundreds, thousands, however many across the world. I'm always intrigued when I sit down and talk to ex-pros to go, right, let's look at the mental side of things. Your determination, your grit. When things are difficult, I know, again, we touched on it last night, but when your back's against the wall, what have you really got about you?
Don't take this disrespect. I'm not an ex-pro. I'm still a pro in my head. I'll never change. Never, ever change. You can't get away from it.
Yeah.
I'm a pro. So, how can I... Sorry, can you... See that question again, just because you said that, I went blank, never else.
Yeah, so I was talking about the mentality of being a professional.
The mentality?
You know, like, people have ability, Birdie, and they don't quite go on, but I guess the message, or my biggest message when I'm coaching to players is, ability is only a small part of the story. You've got to have so much more than
it's,
that.
It's minimum. I remember a coach saying to me, if you've not got heart and lungs, you've got nothing. If you can't get about the pitch and you've not got a heart, you've got nothing. you could have the most ability in the world. You see the guy with heart and lungs, he'll eventually take over you. Because it's just in you. You need to get in you, you need adversity to get it. And the mentality of it is you don't give up. You just cannot give up. You just need to. When I'm coaching my player, no coaching, because I'm not really a big coach, I'll be honest. I feel that I'm more of a manager. They'll be able to tell you better. I think you are what you are when you come to your level. You can formations and change things and all, but see, at the end of the day, you've not got the heart to actually go and bust your balls to do that. You're not going to do it. So the mentality is there's more lows, and the highs are very. But my God, man, you fucking make sure you get as many highs as you can. But the lows are hard, like, but that's the mental side of it. How do you cope with them? And there's been stages in my career I've not been able to cope with them. In a comfortable way.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I think it's the side of the game that a lot of people don't realise. And I think these conversations are brilliant because we get to speak about them, right?
I've struggled. No struggled. I would say I have struggled. No, doesn't it? Bullshit. No, I have struggled. But I never really started struggling. I had big responsibilities. Obviously, I've been with Natalie since we've been fucking babies, man. Teenagers. But when I had kids, just before we had kids, we got property and stuff like that. You've got bills and responsibilities and all the rest of it, and you've got to look after. I feel like I took in a duty to look after my wife, and I think every man's the same. But if you're a bricklayer, need a suspect, or a tradesman, and all the rest of it, they've got the same pressure, but they don't get judged with the media. They don't get judged with social media. They don't get like you would open a paper, or you've got a fucking 5 out of 10 or a 4 out of 10. You've got people. I remember coming off Twitter because it. See the mental side of that. That was hard, and I know I touched on it. I think I told you this last night. I remember one Sunday, and I've no scored for 3 or 4 weeks. I was trying to get promotion, and there was a big pressure on me because I was number 9. This was at Falkirk at the time. I remember running, just right. No, but I'm going out to run the morning. Never spoke to Natalie. Me and Natalie never had a conversation a Saturday, and a Sunday, Monday. Tuesday I would get together because we'd always had Wednesday off. I would get my head together, maybe have something to eat, and then that was me back to normal for the weekend. I remember going running, and I ran to Natalie's dad's grave, and I remember thinking, I'm fucked. Letting there, I was like, wow. I wouldn't say I needed help, but I knew I wasn't as strong as I thought it was. That's when I knew mentally it was very, very difficult.
Yeah.
And all it was more a fear of failure. That's it, fear of failure.
And these are the moments in pro football that are real. That's
people
the real
don't
side.
Know that.
Of course.
And by the way, I've not earned enough money to. Okay, I don't need to work. I've got to work. David Beckham still work. Fucking guy owns me. But he's working. He's spending, but he's working. Everybody works. And I've sat in places with like Gordon Strachan and stuff, and they're doing like stuff about their license. You've got to do your hours and stuff like that. These guys are all still working. So see, it doesn't matter what you earn. You've still got to work. If you don't work, man, you die in there. So it's not like you're sitting, oh, play football, you're a footballer. Not. People think because you play football that they can abuse you. See the most abuse I've ever had has been here. For a certain club. Not just on the terraces, I mean, in private mails between me and my wife and it. It's been shocking, but that's another thing. But the thing about being a footballer that people don't see is... I would call it the dark hours. It's very, very difficult. And my wife's went through that. like even yesterday, she texts me after yesterday's result. I think there's something happened about a month ago, and people have said they've seen a change in me, especially people I work with at the club in it. Because see, if I normally had the result, I could drag this full place down. Not the full place, I could drag. I knew my demeanour would drag people down. And there's times I went, ah, fuck it. But I've got to be better than that, because I'm the leader of it. And my wife phoned me, texted me yesterday, she went, John, I can't go through with this anymore. That's another weekend ruined. That's what she texted me. And I went, I've told you, that's done. I says, we're good, man. We can change. What can we change? But give. What can me, my players, or whatever? So how you're not in control of that? I'm not in control of that. You can only give your best. Yeah. I said, and see if that isn't good enough. Well, we just go again next year. That I've made peace with it. It's not me. Maybe it's me trying to deal with fear of failure. That is probably no. That's what it is. But it's the best way to deal with it, because if I'm gonna do. Well, I'll tell you what, see my boy yesterday? My boy came onto the pitch. So we get beat 1-0. Right, it's Abra League, I'll just put it in everything. We're 2 points clear. We lose the game 1-0. They score by 5-6 minutes to go. But it's still in my hands. I don't know when this is going to go, but this time it's still in my hands. My wee boy ran on the pitch and came to me on the park and went, Dad, it's okay, mate. It's in my hands, you've done your best. That was my boy at 8 years old, but that shows you what happens if my behaviours in that house, he's worried about how I'm that wee man is sound. Mm. It was the best thing ever happened. Well, I do think, it was only 3 or 4 weeks ago, but I think I've got better with dealing with things as in the football environment. But I was like, oh, wow. Everything that day affects you, mate. So my football affects my full house. And my daughter will say to me when we leave, make sure you win. She's 6, man.
Bless her.
But that's it. But that's my life. That's for life. See, if we never had that. Well, no, I'm saying me and Natalie. I wouldn't. No, the kids, but if me and Natalie never had that, man, what I'll be then? Because but she'll go, I don't want this, I don't want this, but she loves it. She loves me going, fucking hell, man, you stuck 2 fingers up with him. Because that's what, she's been there for 20 odd years. Do you know what I mean?
It's part of it.
But there's a way of dealing with it, so it doesn't drag into other things. That's the thing I've got to learn. But mentally it's difficult, man. A big question that you could go in for hours with that, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, as you were talking, the understanding of it is, it's easier said than done, Birdie. Every time I talk to you, I can tell that you're a winner, a grafter, and it's good for actually people to see you sitting here being so open, talking about that, and how it affects the whole dynamic of the family. Your whole weekend, your mood. Oh. This is the reality of football. It's brilliant. It's really good for people to see the other side of it. I am going to get us back on the timeline. That Sorry. Was brilliant. No, please. That was real, real good stuff there that you were saying. But I want to just jump back to when you had left that team. So you decided to leave that team because you didn't get the trophy. Then you went somewhere else,
That wasn't why I left. Yeah. Right. I had an absolute great time. We never get beat for like 3 years or something at Wolves. And the goalkeeper at the time was a guy called Alec Hardy. And he went to Rangers. Rangers Boys Club, which is affiliation, obviously, Rangers Football Club. And there's no point being, I was a decent player, they asked me to go. I went in trial, and then I made the decision that I wanted to go. They were the first ones to put me up front, and I ended up going back into centre.
You're all right, mate.
I ended up going back into centre midfield. So I went in that trial, it went well, and they wanted, actually scored 5 goals that night, actually. I did. I scored 5 goals. I ground it. Mum, I've got a memory like an elephant, right? But it seemed it comes to things that I've done wrong. I do not remember it. And I scored 5 goals that night. I remember my dad and my grand at the game, and they were like, look, we'd like to sign you in it. So I went and spoke to the manager, who I was really close with. I was really close with his friend, guy Alec Lundy, brilliant. So he was absolutely brilliant. And his boy, Sean, really close with. And I says, look, I'm going to go to another team. And it didn't really end well, to be honest. I was like, right, I wasn't allowed to go and say bye to my friends. And go, no, you can't come back. That's you, done, boom, tracksuit, gives this. And which, look, at that age, I remember going, wow, man, I actually changed my mind. See, when I left, I mean, no, I'll just go back because I upset somebody. I was like, no, I'll just go back. My dad's like, sit in your arse. You made your decision. You're going, that's it. And then that's when it became more, I would say, judgmental and professional at the age of 10.
So was that a step into an academy as opposed we
played in the same league and all that.
Right.
But Rangers, there were scouts. I didn't realise this at the time, but there were scouts all over the place watching it. From me going there, I ended up at going to train at Newcastle, going to Derby, had numerous clubs want me. It was an opportunity, actually, going to Derby and moving down there at the age of 13, I think it was. There was a boy, actually, I went to school with. He was a year above me, actually, done it. A boy called Gary Quigg, done really well at Shamrock Rovers and stuff like that. That opened up everything. That age at 10-year-old, then it became serious. And I knew at that age I was getting judged.
You felt the difference between two clubs?
No, the difference in the clubs, because the clubs ended up, they were in the same league. But I knew that, well, I was there to win. We had to win. So you were getting judged to win, that was it. There was at 10-year-old, and then you'd, well, for instance, just say, so you've got a team of 16, and two boys have been scouted to go into Ibrox to train. But there's another 14 that have not. I'm going in there. So if somebody was picked to go to Hearts, I went to Hearts training. So during the week, I've been training the boys' club. I've been training with Hearts, Celtic, Rangers, and then playing a Saturday for Rangers boys' club. So I made sure, I was like, I'm the fucking... Like, it was just like, no, I'm... Sometimes arrogant. It did sound that. I was like, no, I'm the best, man. I'm gone. That was it. But it wasn't arrogant. I was just... At that age, I remember the judgmental stuff.
You need that, Birdie. You do need that side of belief. Do we call it arrogance? Do you call it confidence? No. I think it's how you act, whether it's arrogance or confidence.
I know,
right?
I'm arrogant. I know I come across very arrogant. I know that. But that's maybe because I've been fucking kicked that much that I feel, nah, I need to be.
Yeah.
Because if I'm not, who's going to look after me? Nobody wants to look after me in the pitch. All right, your teammates, and that'll help you out, but see when the ball comes down, the nuts come down to you, I've got to take the ball off somebody and make a pass. My teammate who'll look after me, by the way, I know I've got teammates right this moment in time who'll look after me, but they'll not be able to take the ball and make that fucking pass that I've got to make.
Yeah.
So you need to have the balls about it, man. And so, I know I've went off it again, but...
No.
That happened for that age, and that's where it started to get serious. But I did keep winning awards.
Love it.
I went there, the under 10s, and I won Players' Player, and I won Player of the Year. Under 11s, Players' Player of the Year.
Yeah.
Aye. And actually 12s as well. I think I won 12s, and then at 13s I changed. I went to Celtic.
You went to Celtic. Aye. You did mention that you had the opportunity to go to Derby. What was that, just you didn't want to relocate? What happened there?
Two big brothers, my mum and dad, obviously. My mum was a teacher. She ended up a head teacher and stuff like that. My dad had a business. He was a welder and a blacksmith. I think that was in the process. My old man, he became a chef. Which is a right good chef. We're talking Michelin star stuff, do you know what I mean? He's top draw.
Yeah, that's class.
It's quite difficult when you go for meals with him because...
I've always thought that about chefs, go out to eat and they're like, what is this?
See, when you go out for a meal with my dad, right, and he's eating, he eats it that quick because he doesn't want to eat it. Because he's like, I can do better than that for the money it's getting paid. It's no tighter then. He's 100% no tight. But it was just like, that's no quality.
He just knows.
He's just got a good palate. Do you know what I mean? The big man's eating caviar for breakfast on the boat. Do you know what I mean? But so it was an option. I remember it being an option, but it never came to that. It was more just the way you are. But I get, see, when I achieved something, I found that when I was younger, I changed clubs because I wanted another challenge. Even at that age, there was a look at the size of me. You know what I mean? I'm not the biggest, but I remember the growth spot, and I was miles behind everybody. And I started struggling. Like, I remember waking up one Sunday and my thighs were killing me, and it was a big game, right? And I'm only 12 year old at the time. Was I 12 or 11? My legs were in. Like, I was like, but I was growing. But looking back, I don't know. So if I can see it, my wee boy, my mum and dad, I told them, mate, get on, mate. Just fucking run. I remember in bits, and Rangers pulled me. You know, the boys' club, the club. I remember, mate, what's happening? You can't get about the pitch. How you? About, my legs were sore. Nah, your legs aren't. I says, they were sore. And it just kind of snowballed for there, and people were starting to overtake me. Being small and everybody's bigger than me, growing in it. My bullet was still there. I could put a pass in it, but I just couldn't get a boot. I was just behind. And I had an opportunity to go to Celtic. A guy, Eric Black, we actually came and watched me. I played with Rangers against Celtic, and he watched me. And I had a good game that day. And he said to my mum and dad, I want him at the football club. So I went to Celtic for under 13s, 14s. And when I signed, so Eric Black was the one that wanted me in. As soon as I went in, Eric Black ended up becoming the assistant manager of the first team under Joe Venglos. So that was how highly thought he was. He's actually been at Birmingham and done a lot down south and that. I think Eric won a European Cup actually with Aberdeen. But it just changed. I remember I never felt part of it at Celtic. I felt like an outsider. I never felt that they actually thought that I was good enough, which, when you look through my history, I've not been good enough to play with Celtic.
But to feel that early on is... Why did you feel that?
There wasn't a love. There wasn't... It was just like, I was... When I'm saying about the two, I was a 14.
Right.
But, so I knew what it was like to be there, and then I went, wow. And I took... I just messed about. No, messed about. I remember kidding mum. Because I was struggling, I remember kidding on my mum. I was going to training and I wouldn't go to training. Because Celtic Park's a mile for me. But you get picked up and took down. You would do your schoolwork on the Monday, and then you would do like coordination, so your fast feet and all that. That would all be done at Celtic Park. And then Wednesday, Friday, you would train. I used to kid on and was going to train. I didn't go.
Yeah.
Because I didn't want to face it. That was struggling. Because I was scared of facing the failure.
Do you reckon that was tougher as well because you had always been in that too?
100%, yeah. 100%, 100%. And when I got released for Celtic, which we went to a tournament. We went and played a tournament in Belgium. Davy Marshall played with, I think he was at Derby. Davy played in the Premiership with Cardiff and all the rest of Scotland International. Me and Davy were quite close, we went to the same school together. And we went to a tournament in... Belgium, and it had Inter Milan, Ajax, I mean, all the top European teams, like, unreal. We won it. Ross Wallace was played with Sheffield Wednesday and Sunderland and stuff like that. Ross Wallace won player of the tournament, unreal, so he was, for us.
Won it,
us.
Yeah.
Oh, won it, unreal. And I remember seeing him, see, you're talking about, like, he was the two. I remember seeing him and going, holy biscuits. This guy, man.
Yeah.
But he was like, because of the age group, he was like a year above. But I remember saying, man, he could go to Shiver.
Yeah, yeah, right? Yeah.
And you were like, man, fucking hell. But we won this tournament. That was how good we were. But instead of me thinking, I've played every game, I started every game. Why am I not thinking I'm fucking... But I don't want to be part. But why am I not thinking how good to be? Because how good's this going to take us? I was like, nah, fucking hell, man, I'm struggling here. My mindset totally changed at that age. I'm struggling here. I need to be better than him. He became my target. But not a target in a bad way, because I had the utmost respect for him.
Yeah.
But it was more like, fucking hell, I'm not as good as him. So Celtic in a way were right, because I never had it then to actually go, like the balls for it.
Yeah.
To actually go, well, I'll hang in here. No going to training or the rest. So we see when I see people doing it now, I'm like, mate, you're full of shite.
Yeah.
You pushed it.
You can see through it.
You pushed it. You know, yeah. Because that's the way I done it. But that was a big...
Your mindset intrigues me.
I'm talking like that I'd... Baby, Everton was amazing, man. I had the best fucking football childhood you could imagine.
Yeah.
Because I won things.
Your mindset...
But it's weird, can I win? There you go again. I've went, can I win things? I'll enjoy it from winning.
Yeah. If you're a... I think a lot of players that are in that situation are going, I'm part of a team who's just gone and won this, this and this. Your mindset is not, I'm part of this, starting every game, winning tournaments. Sure. You're like, that ain't enough for me.
No. my mentality, but obviously, like, because of the podcast and stuff, you see a lot, and I look at my wee bra, right? Very end, my middle brother, I've got two young brothers, Christopher and George. The middle one, George, always done individual sports, done the swimming, which I mentioned earlier, and done the boxing. That's your mentality then. I'm very, as a manager, that sounds weirdly to say, very individual minded, as in behaviours. See football, right? Football's the most individual game you can get. See, a boxer, he's got four or five people trying to make him the best he can be.
And just him?
Just him. To go and perform in that ring. Right? Same with swimming. Same with... there's numerous individual sports, right? See, football. Nobody in that park or anybody else in this fucking football club can make you better. They can make you better. There's no team behind them. That team behind you going, I'll do what I can. There's your food, there's it. You need to do it yourself, man. There's nobody sitting about you in a house, they're all staying together, to make you better on a Saturday for 3 o'clock. You've got to be the one that does it yourself. That's it.
I've never thought about it that way.
I say to my players all the time, that's it. You have got to, you're your own team. In a team. Now see if that team's no, that wee group's no doing it. Now see if there's, like you go to the boxer, right? Everybody's getting paid to do that. They don't want to do that. If they were doing it for nothing, they wouldn't be there helping. Say Joshua, right? They wouldn't be helping him. They're not getting paid. They've just gone there for nothing.
Yeah.
But see here, in football, there's a guy employed to deal with like, my assistants and all the rest of it, right? They're employed to deal with 22, 23 people, basically. Then you've got the reserves, and then you've got the 18s that are the same. There's no individual stuff to make you better. It's in there. It's in your heart to make you better. You've got to do it yourself.
Touching on that point, I know we both played for Scotty Miller down at Lang Warren, but I said to him, I'm always learning off him. Incredible coach, as we spoke about last night, but sessions he's put on. I said to him the other day, how as a coach do you turn up? And I go, I was assessing it, so I was suspended that week, and I was in and around it, in the dressing room before a game, and I go, how as a coach, when your training's been spot on, your detail of the other team, the way you're going to play is spot on, and it was just before the lads were about to head out for the game, I said, how do you deal with as a coach, you're looking around the room, because I was doing it myself as I was had the week off, and I'm going, I wonder if he's done what he should have to prepare for this game. I wonder if he's been, you know, eating, sleeping the correct way to be right for this moment now, the game. How many of them have done it?
Which he's employing you to do.
But how many do you reckon do it? And if you don't know, like...
You don't know.
With us, Birdie, this year, you go, you don't know what you're going to get from us. And I go, how do you deal with that as a coach? Do you ever get that as a coach?
As a coach, yeah. I know what I'm getting off my boys.
You do know, yeah.
I know what I'm getting off my boys.
Yeah.
I trust them. I wouldn't employ them. The way I look at it is, if I needed a job done in my house, I would employ the guys to be in my house. And I trust him. And maybe that's how I'm so emotional with him, because if I feel they've no goat to where I think they could get to, that hurts me. It's no that ain't about like me feeling around, because I feel I've done. I can sleep at night knowing I've done what I can do.
Yeah.
Like, to the extent. But if they boys haven't done it, they're letting themselves down. And I'm telling you, in 20 years' time, it's their regret. But as going back as a coach, it's so frustrating when you can smell it. I'm saying I trust them. Of course I trust them. I wouldn't employ them and be on my team, but I'm no daft either.
Yeah.
You can see it in training. You just know. My wife always says to me, I can tell with your eyes. Obviously, I've had a few beers last night, but I can walk in the house and she can go, what happened?
Really, yes. He knows you like that.
What happened? Because we've said, right, we'll not bring it home. And she goes, what happened? And you can tell with boys, like, there's some boys that something could happen or arrest it, but you can just tell that, like, I'll no name a player. I went to him, I just knew there was something no right with him, and I went to him, I said, how's things, what's happening? Oh, I'm moving. And he told us, I was like, but I knew, I could just smell it. But that's not, that's just, because she's a coach, this is where as a player coach it becomes difficult, because I'm still a player, so they can talk to me as a player. I don't mind that. But she's a coach, that becomes hard. Like, see, you're saying about Scotty, because Scotty's top notch. Scotty's one of the best coaches I've ever worked under. I thought he was unbelievable. He pure got you, he got inside of you. Like, his message really, really touched you. And that's how, when you're looking about your players, do you actually think you know? I do think, you know, I look and talk in my dressing room, but have I been in dressing rooms that they've no done that 100%, and I struggled with it as a player. I wasn't a good teammate at times, because of it. I don't think people done enough, because my standards were there.
Yeah.
No, just ability standards. I wouldn't talk to somebody if they weren't good enough in a dressing room. I'd be like, nah, fuck him. I remember, right, I'm no kidding, right, a manager asked me about a player, right, I played with him. I'm no mentioning the club, because I'll end up, I don't want to think me the boy, right. So, manager asked me, what do you think of this player? I went, when he touched my bars, Paul, no for me. I didn't enjoy being in the dressing room. He's no my type of person. And at this time, I was one of the bigger boys. No, the bigger boys, there was four or five of us, I'm going to name a team, Falkirk was very... Like, as a manager would say, run the dressing room, as in, like a good way, because it was like, no, this is the way we go, we sort it, there's no bullshit, you fucking behave, you train, and this was, everybody was to look after ourselves type of thing, and see what you're saying about a manager. I guarantee you, he had 100% confidence in that dressing room, because of that. You top, like Lee Muller, David McCracken, Mark Kerr, and I was one of them. Now, he asked me about signing a player, and I says, nah, when you touch him. He asked another player and the team that was eventually getting into that sort of a group. He was mates with him, and I'm really pally with the other guy. He went, nah, good player, I would do all right for us, and all that. I was like, nah, even the last 2 minutes, man. So we done pre-season. I was like, fucking hell, he's a cock, man. But anyway, right, so we're playing the first league game, the first league cup game of the season. I'm on the bench, right, this character's playing. I'm on the bench. He wasn't playing steady, he was a different position, right? And the manager's done that, and the dugout, he's turned round, right? And he's done that. He said to Rubble, you told me he was a good player. That's just how ruthless it was, right? Because at the end of the day, this is this guy's employment. Turned around to the guy that said, he put his name up and said, no, he's a good player. But he was passing on, he was basically having a dig. He needs to get his fucking finger out, have a word with him. He's went, you told me he was a good player, and I popped out, and I went, I told you he's fucking shit. But that was me, man. I was ruthless with stuff like that.
Yeah.
Like, really, I looked at it as, no, man, you're stopping us going where we need to go. You know, I played with a guy, Stephen Simmons, right? Played with Hearts and that. Fuck it. And he will see this, because we're on social media and stuff like that. The guy, really, really good pal. He's a good, no, really good pal, but see my mate, see if I seen him, it's like, how you doing? Like, we don't speak, but see, we see each other, it'd be like, big man, how you, it'd be a, there's just that much respect for each other. I remember him on the pitch going like that to the manager, oh, take him off. You can't play with him. Take him off. Like, see, the people decide that take him off, no good enough. And see if you've done that to now. Well, what would happen? If you say to a player now, take him off.
Mate.
Decide. And I've done it, by the way. I've done it. I've done it.
Because here?
No, here.
Right.
No, I have once when I was a player. It was out of order. Shocking. I shouldn't have never done it. But that was the way I've been brought up.
Yeah.
My life brought up, football and life, is you're taking food off my table, man. There's a win bonus. It was so ruthless. Nah, I'm not fucking losing. If he's not good enough, get him out. It's a cancer, cut him out. That was how it was. Nah, he's not going to get us. I mean, Gaffer, that's not good enough. See if the Gaffer thought, no, I think he'll come good. Ah, fair enough. You back the gap. But he keeps playing him. But that was what it was like. And no Scottish football. Obviously, I would say British football because there's boys, there's English people come into my dressing room and everybody from around the world came in. But that was, no, you fucking doing that. But I saw that changing when I was probably about 31, I would say. I went, this is in trouble.
Yeah.
And I smelt it with a club.
It's changed. It's changed a lot.
And they got relegated. I remember we actually came second in the league, right? And that, see the January, in the transfer window, we came second. I said, and my mate, Mark Kerzo, will watch this. And I said, mate, we'll get relegated. This club will get relegated next year. He went, fucking shut up, man. You're a fucking maniac. I mean, I'm telling you, the recruitment's not good enough. We'll get relegated next year. And I'll not be fucking here to get relegated. I left in the summer. We came second in between Rangers and Dundee United. Came second. I left. I remember speaking to the manager. I think I told you about this last night. The manager spoke about leaving. I was like, the experienced ones are always ones that get kicked out the door, right? I was like, it was on maternity. Got a good offer. He got Inverness. Met unbelievable people. Went up there and I went, they beat us in the League Cup section, right? And there was a few things, nobody manager, there was other people mentioned things saying, I fucking bear did that. I went, mate, you'll get relegated. I'm fucking telling you, you'll get relegated. They get relegated. The manager was away in about 3 or 4 months. By the way, top manager, like, no manager as in coaching that, but he was like, manager, like, he managed. The way he worked with me was fucking different class. He put a wee doubt in me because put a fucking doubt in me, I'm back. I'll fucking show you. That was my attitude, and he used to work that. He was class. He was very good with all the boys in the dressing room, managed it really well, and he brought in an arm manager that I could smell it. I could just smell it, but he got relegated. And I never turned around, I wouldn't go, because my mate was away by then, because he was inexperienced, he was away. He got put out in the January. The other one went to Livingston and ended up fucking winning the league, and Cracks went to, Lee ended up in the Premier League. The other one ended up winning the league with United, and Cracks went to Peterhead. Lost. And you could smell, and that was a fucking right good club. They've still not got out of League One.
Really, yeah.
Done for the last, so what was that? That's about 6-7 years. That was a team that was on the brink of promotion.
Yeah.
But see, if you take that out of a dressing room, you're done.
And it's hard to get it back.
You take it, but you end up, you're the bad guy.
Yeah.
So, see at that time, right, when it was successful, there was that many people wanted to go that side. So you think there was a boy, Blair Alston, Craig Sibbald, Will Volks ended up Welsh international. We'd like top players, like, and everybody followed it. But see, when the recruitment's no any better, well, it's easier to go. So that became smaller because boys moved on, good moves, and then that became smaller and that goes that side. So that cancer's a fucking bad, but that gets bigger, and then it's easier to fail then instead of fooling the people that made it successful.
If you've got a squad of 22, for instance,
aye,
and 21 of them, 20 of them are like you high standards and you're...
No,
you're,
obviously, no, I think you only need six or seven.
Do you?
Oh, six or seven, because then another, they'll see, it, there's a wee point, right? You've been in dressing rooms, there's a point. You can go that way or that way with a manager. But see if you follow the process that you believe is good, and there's good boys in there, say there was six or seven, you'd even need a fucking good manager. You just need a good dressing room that's going to take that. So see boys that are wanting to go and do something better in their career, you know the boy that's making an asset, no eating right, no drinking right, out every weekend. Go with him, man. Go with him, it's earned a career, earned a living out of the game. Never. People say you've no worked a day in your life. Because you're no wondering about in a pair of worky boots doesn't mean you're no working. But go and be a footballer. These guys have been footballers fully them, man. Do what they done. That's what happened at Falkirk, and then it totally changed because they boys weren't there. In my opinion.
Yeah.
And I think that happens in every other dressing room. You can see it with clubs. You can smell it. You just smell it.
It's interesting. The culture of...
I know I keep going on in a tandem here.
Listen, it's brilliant to hear. And again, I go back to that point of people realising what football's like and the brutality of it and those standards that you were talking about there at Falkirk being high and having a leadership group. I think it's dying in the game where you can't, you know, you can't say anything to anyone.
Well, you mentioned the word leadership group. That was never created. That just happened. Yeah. It wasn't like you see this when your manager's going, right, I'm going to create a leadership group. Fucking bollocks, man. The boys take care of the dressing room. You can be 21, 22 and be a big character. I was a big character at 22. I'm no fucking beating about the pool. I was in a dressing room. I was involved in a team that got promoted to Premier League. And I dropped down to League 2 because I knew I wasn't good enough to go and play. So I dropped down to make sure I played I went, I'm going to fucking score goals and I'll be back here. That was my attitude. Whereas, so I became a big character in that dressing room. And if you ever spoke to boys in that dressing room, you'd know that. But that's because where I was, I learnt from, there's a guy, Mark Riley, who's my hero, Kevin McGowan, one of my heroes, Andy Mullen, there's another one. You were in a dressing room, you're like, man, see when you took that, it always goes. Everywhere, see if you've got that in the dressing room, you'll go.
And it can't be faked. You know, like you say about creating leadership groups. It's not
nonsense. How can you make somebody be a leader? I'm going to create a wee group, and then if he's done wrong, I'm going to. It's just a grassing group. Don't fucking tell the manager in. Don't tell me you don't need to know. I'll tell you, none of my players ever came to me and said anything about a player. He's doing this, he's doing that. And that, do you know what? I think that's amazing. Because they're looking after their teammate. Don't fucking. There's plenty of people about the fucking. Because manager is like a wee town. Not a town, there's 100,000 people here. This is within me city, right? People tell me where everybody is. I don't even need to leave the fucking house. This guy was here, that guy was, he was in Red Rooster, he was in fucking, he was in a golf course, and then you know what it is with social media, know what I mean? You do have a wee account that's going to fucking see everybody. You need to be daft not to have it, do you know what I mean? It's not my name, and the boys will be watching this, and they don't even fucking know what I'm up, but I know what they're doing. I've no following them about, but you know what you're doing. You don't think that's happening when I was back home, like? When the social media and all that started coming, 100%. But see, people, I remember being in a dressing room at Dundee, and a guy that I really, really respected before I went to the dressing room was a grass. And that finished us, and that's how we get relegated. Not just him. You can go a bit of bullying and all that. But see, at the end of the day, see, dressings, you've got somebody gone fucking snitching, man. Man, you're not good to anybody.
Yeah.
Can waste a time, man.
Yeah.
Never went in a tandem again.
I'm letting you go, mate.
No, but what, see, leadership groups, how can you go into a dressing room as a new manager, right, and go, right, just say, Rogan, Brad, just go, bang, 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 put all these together, right? Did I get that right, Bradley? Bradley. how can you go, right, there's my leadership group. How's that impossible to create that? What if the boys haven't got respect to the dressing room? What if they're the bad ones that are not doing the right things? And you're sacked. You've actually failed before you've even started. Now, they might go, we'll do it for 6 months and we'll watch. 6 months, you might be at a fucking job. So what are you talking about? It's just buzzwords. The dressing room would take... Sign the characters and go like, mate, I know you'll be good in the dressing room. Do you need to tell them? Because you do your homework to know you'll be good in the fucking dressing room. So it's a nonsense. And this is where... people get all thing-made about it, all the wee birds, and I'm a young coach. Well, I wouldn't class myself as a coach, I think as a manager. We budge birds going, oh, we'll fucking do this, we'll do that. And by the way, see if people have done, and it's worked for them, fair play to them. Just my opinion, I'm not saying I'm right.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, but I think a dressing room takes care of itself with the behaviours of people in the dressing room. No wee groups, wee groups. Oh, you can't say that to him. You can't. Fuck off, man. He's peace. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because see if somebody in the group, see if I wasn't in the fucking, well, there you go, with the 14 to 2, see if I wasn't in the group, I'd go, how am I on the fucking group? I'd be going to the manager's door and go, how am I on the group? But you know, trust me, like, don't trust me, I'm not playing for you. That would be my attitude there.
Yeah.
So the group becomes a fucking joke. How do you get into the group? Wait, it's a fucking group. We'll talk about group. But what is it all about, man? Know what I mean? It's fucking bollocks.
Yeah.
It is.
Yeah. I agree.
Because if I get signed and I'm in the door, like, say, a week, or this wee group's away to talk to the manager, I'd be like, there's a seabird, bang, bang, bang. They'll not do for me, man. I wouldn't trust them as far as I could throw them, yeah, if they were in the group. Crab, see if somebody asked me to go in the fucking group, I'd be like, nah, get a full dressing room. Just talk in front of the dressing room. Don't need to go and talk in the room, man.
Yeah.
Just say what you've got to say here. No, see, we need to start fighting that. Just fucking tell us. Just tell them. You're not behaving right. Or he was out on a fucking Monday night, or he was, oh, fuck off, man. Pathetic. That is pathetic. Yeah. You've actually, that is pathetic. Tell me you're not in the leadership group at Langmore.
I hate to break it to you. No, I'm not. I'm not. No. I'm not.
Have you just got a leadership group?
No, we haven't. No. He's lying.
Well, if you sign me, you'd be fucking better get me in it. Just open up the dressing room.
We haven't. Do you know, as you were talking and ranting there, I was going, oh, thank God I'm not in a leadership group.
man, come on.
I get it.
Think about it, right? See, you go on a building site or whatever, and there's 20 guys, and there's a mad dog in it, man, that grasses everybody. And see, somebody's out and had a few beers on a Sunday, and a guy's come in on Monday. He's no pulling his weight, but he covers his butt. That bastard grassed him. Wait, is he any good to anybody? No, but get him out. Because I'll tell you what, see, the guy actually goes and has a cut of beer and comes in days and turns up at his butt. He's better than the grass who's sitting there, be fucking, he's like having a wee ice bath at fucking 7 o'clock on a Sunday night. The rest of them are worth a monkeys, man. Because you'd rather somebody is honest. See, honest, you go, mate, by the way, I've had a few beers, but I'm going up my pan in the day, and then, see, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday,
yeah,
I'll fucking, did I leave it Wednesday there? It's because of the football on here. But, do you know what I mean? You would, you know your pan in and cover it. That's fine. You go like that all day, man. Sound. See the mad dogs? Ah, no, what the fuck.
When you were at Celtic, how long were you there? Did you do YT there?
No, I only done a year there. I get released, and the players we had were fucking, there was Charlie Mulgrew, Ross Wallace, David Marshall, I'm just naming, and then there was a boy, Adam McGiddy, man. Adam is actually a year younger than me. We played in Glasgow Select together. And his dad was a player. His dad was... See, when you think of the ruthlessness, right, and the behaviours and that, I remember, so we were like under-10s, Glasgow Select, so all the best players got selected, and we were going to play in Edinburgh, we were going to play everybody about Scotland, sometimes you could do in South and that. And I remember on the bus, and I was sitting up the back of the bus with everybody else. You know what it's like?
Yeah.
Aidan, wasn't he? Aidan sat down the front with his dad. But his dad had a football mentality because he played with Sheffield Wednesday and all the rest of it. And he behaved correctly. We were just fucking jumping in and out of toilets, fucking flinging things about. And wasn't it later on, I remember looking going, that boy was never going to fail. His ability was there. But that mentality was there. He was never ever going to fail. Just silly wee things. People think, I remember thinking at the time, fucking Aidan, sitting down there with his dad. Well, you know what we all say? No, but he was thinking he was so much... No better than us. I'm going to a different path. And I'm like, man... I've seen him doing his interviews, and I really enjoy listening to him, because when I see him speaking stuff like that, I'm like, man, you've fucking got it. Like, he knows how good he is.
Some player as well,
Oh, fucking... Aye. But how? Could he worked his nuts off. That boy absolutely worked at everything. He played in a Celtic team. He made his debut in a Celtic team with Chris Sutton, John Hartson and Henrik Larsson. It's 17-year-old and scored. Wow, man, that takes some balls.
You got to be some player to do
and
that.
It doesn't get the respect in Scotland because how good he is, as in how good he is because he went and played with Republic Ireland. And that's a fact. That's a fact. He was one of the best talents Scotland's ever had. And he doesn't get anywhere near the attention that he should have, in my opinion.
Yeah, yeah.
Just because because of the way it is with Celtic and Rangers and the bigotry and stuff like that, but the sectarianism back home.
Yeah.
But he's top notch, man.
Where did you go after Celtic? So you were there for a year?
I went and played boys club after that. I got released.
Oh, did you?
I lost the fight. Just totally because I wasn't in the two to speak. Just I didn't even realise about that until we started talking it earlier. But there was a few teams, Hibs, Livingston and stuff like that. I went to Motherwell, actually went there and they kicked me out for my behaviour.
Really?
Went to a tournament down in Newcastle and we won the tournament and actually played quite well in it. But my behaviour, no in a bad way, I was just a stupid wee boy, man.
What were you doing?
Fucking. Right, so we stayed in a hotel in Newcastle, right? So, what age am I? I'm trying to think, right, so I'll be 14, 15. Yeah. Do you know what it was? I was a late developer, so immature, late developer, everybody's fucking shaving and that, and I'm no. Right. So I had to make a fucking attention. So I remember us sitting so we're going into a lift. Fuck it, this is pathetic, man. And I actually go, everybody, it was all women in it, all guys on the lift. The fucking lift broke. I was like, no, it's all right. This wee guy, it's fucking, my ears are still sticking out, but they looked worse when I was younger, right? It was like, oh my God. And bright ginger hair like my beard, right? This is just fucking get darkly grown, getting older. And it was, see when I look back, I was like, what the fuck was I doing, man? It was a guy, Davey McParlin was a coach. And he was, maybe correct me if I'm right, I'm sure he was something to do with Jock Steen at Celtic, right? But he was a manager of Partick Thistle, but won a Scottish Cup and stuff like that. Now, he knew his stuff. He brung through Paul McStay and all that at Celtic. And he was a manager at the time, and I'm fucking dragging everybody in a lift. All women in it. All guys. The fucking lift broke halfway up. We're stuck in a lift. Now, there was other things, fucking flying things down the bus. Just being an arsehole. A pest. See that? Just going into school and you'll be like, man, know what? You get put out of class. That's basically what happened.
So what do you do in the lift?
Just get as many bodies as I could in. So all the older people were there. So they were in first, right? All the older people were in first. So they think, oh, nice boy. He's gone, oh, thank you very much, son. And all that. I'm like, fucking hell, I've got a full team coming in here. Back, boys, lads, get in, man. So see, when they get out, they were not talking like that because their nose was not fucking smushed. Everybody was in, it fucking broke halfway up. So I'm like, nobody, right, so we end up, we get fixed, fire brigade, and all that. Everybody came sorted, right? So I was like, don't fucking grass, man, nobody grass, obviously. Nobody that's in the circle, the leadership group stuck me in. No, they never, right? You know what it's like, kids?
Yeah.
You're getting kicked out if you don't tell me what happened. Totally get it. So I get emptied, and do you know what? I never even told my man that.
Really?
I took the phone call and I let my man and dad take me to training. I went training, I walked in that dressing room, stuck chain gear on, and I trained that day. I was released. And the manager's like, what are you doing here? I was like, I'm fucking training. I'm going to tell my man that. You going to tell my man that? So I trained that full session and they went and told my man that.
What did your mum and dad say?
Oh, I was done.
Yeah.
Oh, done. Because at that time, I've had like, clubs in England and that. Fancy me. I've been at Celtic Rangers, all the rest of it, and then I've got to Motherwell and I had nothing after that. Nobody would take me. I wrote letters to clubs, every club in Scotland outside the Premier League, to ask, let me in and try them.
And no one was having a bar of it, no?
Nobody would touch it, man. They left me. Which is...
It just shows, man.
No, but I wanted it that much. I was like, no. And I remember my ma sitting and me done this later. No, they gave me... My ma and dad gave me... I'm saying my mum and dad. I know, obviously, this... Did we say ma back came in Melbourne? Back came in Melbourne. Ma? Mum. Yeah. That's my mum, right? Ma's my mum, right? So my mum and dad... I remember my mum sitting with me. And me wrote this letter. And we said... I didn't think emails were there, man. We sent it to every club in Scotland, bar the ones that I was already.
Yeah.
I wasn't embarrassed with it, like, I was just determined to get back in, and nobody taking a bite at it. I'm like, nah. Just causing my behaviour, isn't it? It was shocking. And see, that time I was terrible at school. I got to an age about 12 year old that I realised I wasn't good enough at school. So, I'm majorly dyslexic. I'm really, really strong. Obviously, I don't know if you know, but I think I maybe mentioned it, the academy and that. I really, really, really struggle with that. That's, if I could, the end of my life would help me with my reading and writing. That fucking drives me insane, man. So, in school, my behaviour started affecting my football because of that.
Behaviour like that comes from frustration.
I wasn't bad as in... Like a bad boy, I
probably never, just frustrated.
No, I never hurt anybody. I was just a cheeky bastard.
Yeah.
Pure frustration. I remember getting into Spanish, right? They try to teach me Spanish. I can't even write English on a bit of paper. So what are you asking me? No, the only thing I know about it, me, I'm a one. My name is John. Yeah. Wow. I was in it for 2 years. And they'll get up and ask me to speak in front of people in class. Yeah. Now, I couldn't even read a book in front of an English to people.
Yeah.
So why? I'm black.
Do you not get any support?
I'm still getting angry at that.
Yeah.
Or we try different. My mum's got fucking, she's got brains coming out of her ass. She's got Ducks Awards, fucking head teacher. She can speak about 7 languages. Honestly, and I'm not exaggerating with that. My mum is a encyclopedia, man. Pure sponge. But I'm a sponge with different things.
Yeah.
And that's where I've looked. So... See, you're saying about help. We tried, you know, think about it in a house with a woman that's tried everything. My youngest brother's not as bad as me, and I'm not, he'll not be, but my God, man, he's a grafter. He's done amazing because he's found what he's good at.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Whereas my middle brother, he's fucking, but he doesn't, when he was younger, he went down a different road, but he's using it now. Do you know what I mean? But that's still really, really. Bugs me, man. It's hard. That's very frustrating. Because even yesterday at the academy, and I've got, we're opening the girls only clinic, right? So I'm like, what's your name? I'm asking them to put their name in my phone. Cause I'm scared to spell it wrong in front of them. I'll be 38 next month. Fucking embarrassing, know what I mean? Well, it's not embarrassing, but it isn't. Well.
I understand what you're saying.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I understand.
That's hard, Link.
Yeah. No, I understand that, John. 100%.
That's hard.
Right, legends. If you're at this point of the video, that means you're enjoying my content. So make sure that you hit the subscribe button, you hit the like button, and you hit the little notification bell so you don't miss any of my up-and-coming videos.